good morning, everyone. Such a delight to see you all today. My name's Phoebe Scott. I'm a curator at National Gallery Singapore. And it gives me a great deal of pleasure this morning to be able to moderate this panel and to hear the results of this extraordinary process that these young scholars have gone through. So we have three very interesting papers today. And so I think we should hear what they have to say without further ado. Our first speaker is Tanavi Chokpradit. Tanavi is currently a PhD candidate in art history at Birkbeck College, University of London, and a part-time lecturer in Thai modern and contemporary art history at Silpakorn University. And she'll be speaking to us about re-establishing the kingdom, the anti-communist monuments in the Thai highlands.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. And I also thank you, the Ambitious Alignment Program and the National Gallery of Singapore. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you. Okay, today my topic, re-establishing the kingdom, the anti-communist monument in the Thai highlands. For the first slide, on the 25th January 1982, King Phumipol made to set up plaster casts of his footprint at the battalion of Doi Phya Pithak on the top of the mountain Doi Yao in Thung District, Chiang Rai Province. The king granted his footprint to the soldiers who were fighting in the war against the communists in the highlands. One set was retained by the commander and the other was installed in the footprint pavilion in the headquarters of the battalion, which is located in Fort Ming Rai Maharaj in Chiang Rai. Eventually, the counterinsurgency in the highlands ended in March 1982. Phumipol's footprint marked a creation of an emblematic landscape, predicting an end of the conflict over ownership of the highlands with the triumph of the Thai state under the Chakri monarch. The royal footprint does not only exalt his sovereignty on the highlands, but also reveals the most fundamental political concerns of the day, which are the state's fear of communist infiltration and the border security panic. Communism was a major cause for anxieties for the Thai authorities, and it was viewed as an external threat stemming from China, Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. As a political intervention in the highland landscape, the placement of the royal footprints has a symbolic role in spatially defining the boundary of the Thai nation, claiming the right to rule by King Phumipol. But other than King Phumipol's footprints, various forms of memorial dot across the highland landscape. The Thai highland, which includes Payao, which was part of Chiang Rai until 1977, Chiang Rai and Nan is the mountainous natural region and the border to Burma and Laos. It was a sensitive arena during the war against the communist insurgency. This presentation focuses on the proliferation of war memorials, such as statues and monuments in the highland as part of the construction of Thai nationalist ideology during the Cold War era, where its dual body as a kingdom was the first and foremost element of the Thai nationhood. I will discuss how the rhetoric of war memorials engaged in anti-communism and concerns about national security. I argue that the relationship between memory and history, as well as the role of memorials in that relationship, are central to the expression of royal nationalism in Thailand. First, I will briefly provide a historical background of the communist insurgency in the Thai highlands. As the mountainous natural region, home of hill tribes, and the border to Laos, the Thai highlands have a specific geopolitical character. It had been an arena of conflict between the Thai state and the communists for decades. The communist insurgency in Thailand was a guerrilla war lasting from 1965 to 1983. Involving the Communist Party of Thailand, or CPT. the Thai state and the United States. By 1968, the CPT had opened new fronts in Nan and Chiang Rai, marking the beginning of insurgency in northern Thailand. The total number of incidents and total number of armed guerrillas increased steadily. By the end of 1968, the CPT was demonstrating significant military strength. The December battle provided dramatic confirmation. Concerns about developments in Thailand was compounded by concerns about events in Vietnam. By 1975, the governments of Laos, Cambodia, and South Vietnam all fell to communist forces. In this circumstance, frontier turned into strategic areas during the counterinsurgency, since some parts became a bridge for the communists to invade. While members of the CPT were Thai people concerned with achieving more equality, such as improving the situation of lowland farmers impoverished by the high rents on farmland, the party was characterized as foreign and threat to the nation's border. For example, the communists in Nan declared Nan a liberated zone, and also in many parts of on the highland. As such, the territory was the subject of interest of the war against the communists because the Thai state needed to maintain itself as an inseparable kingdom. The national space, the geobody of the nation, can be ambiguous, fluid, or fluctuating, but a fixed boundary. In this context, King Bhumibol, who was conceived as the essence of the nation and Thai-ness, played an important role as a symbol of national unity and anti-communism. Since the 60s, the king and members of the royal family have traveled throughout the country, demonstrating their concerns for the victims of drought and other natural calamities, for the poor in rural villages and tribal communities, and wounded soldiers and policemen. The royal family paid particular attention to the remote mountainous regions, in part because the hill tribe minorities were believed to be especially vulnerable to communist appeals. The king also became increasingly active in a variety of development projects, especially in agricultural sectors. The Border Patrol Police, or BPP, literally means the guardians of the frontier, and the village scouts usually act as royal bodyguards, and the king, queen, and princess matter usually visited remote hill tribe villages in the company of BPP units. The presence of the king in the highland demonstrates the act of territorialization, affirming Bangkok hegemony in the borderland. And in this Cold War context, I believe that memorialization is essential to the construction of national integrity and territorial consolidation. The anti-communist memorials were erected throughout the highlands as mechanisms of power, control, and integration, contrary to most Cold War memorials in the Western Bloc, where abstraction was central to the design. The Cold War memorials in Thailand are figurative, and I believe that figuration is chosen because it best represents heroicism in relation to military cult. Figurative sculptures highlight war drama and heroic deeds in a very comprehensible way. These memorials are recognized as an active performative object. It does not simply signify a material embodiment of remembrance, but conveys and keeps memory alive, but rather a technology of memory that produces and constitutes memory. There are two types of memorials: statue of local historical overlords and monument to the fallen commoner, which includes soldiers, policemen, and volunteer villagers. I will further discuss the relationship between these two types in order to explain the work of memory in this particular context. The first one is statue of local historical overlords. They are called Pao Khun or Pia. These historical overlords in the north of the present-day Thailand are perceived as kings of former Thai kingdoms. There are several statues of these overlords throughout the north, but only some of them were erected in relation to the counterinsurgency. For example, in Piao, Tak, and Phetchabun, the Thai army erected these statues in the military camps in these provinces, or name the military camps after their names to provide moral support to soldiers. For example, พ่อขุนเจืองธรรมิกราชเสียจิ๋วอินขุนเจืองธรรมิกราชแคมอินพะเยาพ่อขุนเจืองธรรมิกราช is the overlord who rule พะเยา then Phu Pham Yao kingdom in the 11th century. According to the myth or history described on the inscribed on the panel behind the statue, he was a great warrior and ruler who expanded his kingdom to Yunnan. The statue of Pho Khun Chiang Thammikarat depicts him as a warrior king with one hand holding a sword. Is this evident that his mythic value derived from the story of ruling and expanding lands through wars? His statue does not simply evoke historical past or myth of the past, but rather relates it to the present situation when ownership of land was in question. The statue celebrates and perpetuates the memory of these acts and integrates them to the current national narrative of counterinsurgency. Pho Khun Chiang Thammikarat is perceived as a guardian spirit of the city of Pa Yau in the wartime, protecting the people from the foreign enemy, which was the communists, and boost the spirit of the soldiers who were fighting against them. The deployment of narratives of the past and historical figures construct and imagine historical territory of the present-day Thailand. As such, the erection of his statue by the Thai state suggests centralization that extends across time and space. The past kingdom become part of the current Thai state, defined by modern maps, and the past overlord became a royal ancestor. It established a fictive kinship between the local overlord and Bhumipol. It incorporates Pho Khun Chiang Thammikarat to the national narrative that marks the king as the ruler and protector of the Thai kingdom, creating a linear perspective to the past by making him a royal ancestor. This fictive kinship affirms Bhumipol the right to rule the northern land. As such, the statue performatively works on both space and time as it contributes to the shaping of memory and contemporary national landscape. The employment of historical past points to the fluidity and elusiveness of memory and its importance in the construction of national narrative as well as state territorialization. Beside the statue of historical overlord, the memorials and monuments to the fallen commoners, soldiers, policemen, and volunteer villagers are another state device in the counterinsurgency. I should also note that there is no clear distinction between the word memorial and monument in the Thai context. The two terms are used interchangeably. The memorials and monuments to the fallen commoner can be found throughout the region, whereas the statue of Pho Khun Chiang Thammikarat provides moral support to the soldiers. Memorials and monuments to the fallen commoner commemorate the state's counterinsurgency and the sacrifices they entail. Those who died in the battle received their honor by having a place in war monuments. Their names were engraved on the base or panels. The commoners were rewarded for committing a noble sacrifice and became national patriots, the fallen hero of Virachon. While memory is bound to place, these memorials create new meaning on landscape where they are located. For example, the memorial to the fallen soldiers of Ban Huay Kon Camp in Nan, where the battlefield is preserved to commemorate the armed struggle between the soldiers and the communists. Individual sacrifice is highlighted by a mark on a spot where each of them were shot dead. These are names of the dead soldiers. By representing the cause of war through citing a number of deaths, this memorial expressed war drama by enchanting authority of war, violence through place setting. It brought preserve and evokes tragic memory of war past on its actual location. At the same site, there is also a monument to the 17 soldiers. The monument features a group of soldiers in action. In their hands are guns and Thai flag. The message is clear. They are fighting for the nation. The names of the 17 fallen were inscribed at the base of the monument. Another example are the memorial to the commoner, policeman, and soldier.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry. Another examples are the memorial to the commoner, policemen, and soldiers at Tung Chang in Nan province, and the monument to the fallen hero in Meng Rai Maharaj camp in Chiang Rai. All of them look very similar to each other. The central imagery is an image of individual, a group of individuals, each represent the three units in action. Figurative sculptures in these memorials highlight the nobility of the common warriors and the unity of the country's citizenries in fighting enemies. Their gestures clearly express fighting spirits. These fallen commoners were not presented as dead fighters, but warriors in fighting, arousing the onlooker the patriotic sensation. The glorification of sacrifice was expressed in a deliberately nationalistic language, thus lacking of other aspects, such as loss and bereavement. In these war memorials, the act of the fallen commoner was noble but not tragic, emphasizing their moral duty to the nation as part of the national community, and insufficiently sensitive to the desolation of loss. There is very little iconography of consolation. The image of two angels on the panel at the memorial in Payao, as they accompany the fallen individuals identified by engraved names on the panels to heaven. Whereas memorial to the fallen soldier in the Great War in Europe functions as object of bereavement, the Cold War Memorial in Thailand boosts the patriotic spirit in a very different way. It seems that the primary purpose was not to help the bereaved recover from their loss, but raising the national flag. By raising the national flag, they intended to reaffirm the Thai nation as the indivisible kingdom. The erection of memorials and monuments to the fallen commoner transformed an empty land to a land of memory. It marked the land where the particular events took place as the site of memory and a commemorative landscape. The highland landscape was impacted by tragic and violent armed struggles. At sites of violence and tragedy, memorials and monuments to the fallen sanctifies the landscape to preserve memory of their moral national deeds. The two types of anti-communist monuments are performative agents that have a crucial role in legitimizing authority and unifying citizens of the nation state during the time when the country was under the communist threat. They work together in defining the highlands as part of the Thai kingdom from the past, date back to the 11th century, to the present, and it is the duty of the Thai people to secure it from foreign enemy, which in this case, the communists. These monuments sought to evoke a sense of patriotism and loyalty to the state in the name of love for the kingdom. The landscape of the Thai highlands, where war monuments were scattered throughout, was a site through which the Thai state, as a kingdom under the king's ruling, was reaffirmed. They act on the border zone and transform this sensitive zone into a symbolic space that aims to fix collective remembering and act as prompts for shared identity as a subject under the Thai king. Meanwhile, the hill tribe, Chao Khao, which literally means the author in Thailand, were redefined as Chao Thai Phu Khao, or Thai people who live on the mountain, whereas many villages were renamed, such as Bandung Pha Thai or Bandung Pha Thong, the names that suggest the Thaiization or centralization from Bangkok. So under years of armed struggles, the kingdom of Thailand symbolized and the king of Thailand was re-established and reaffirmed. The king's footprint reclaimed the national territory on the highland from the grip of communism. At this point, the representation of the king in the form of footprint is remarkable, since it connects him to the Buddha and emphasizes the notion of the Buddhist Dharma king. Whereas the footprint of the Buddha or Prabhupada, which commonly found in Buddhist art, symbolizes the Buddha's presence on earth, Bhumibol's footprint, in a similar manner, it attests of the sovereign body in place, making his presence on the highland and his ownership of this land last forever. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that wonderful paper. I think we'll hold the questions until all three speakers have given their presentations, because it could be interesting to hear them address the same subject together. So for now, I'd like to introduce Roger Nelson to the podium. Roger is a researcher and independent curator based in Phnom Penh, and he's also a PhD candidate at the University of Melbourne, where he's researching modernity and contemporaneity in Cambodian arts and culture in the period between 1955 and 2015. And today he'll be speaking to us on the subject of the work the nation depends on, Nek Dim, Cambodian modern artist.
Thank you, Phoebe, and thank you all for coming. Okay. This paper considers the relationship between realist paintings of landscapes and women and notions of the modern in Cambodia. The discussion centres on the figure of Nek Dim, the most prominent visual artist of the post-independence era, here. First, a brief biographical sketch. Born into an affluent agricultural family in Preiwang province in 1934, Nek Dim's early schooling was disrupted by Japanese military incursion, accompanied by US bombing. In 1949, he entered the School of Cambodian Arts in Phnom Penh, where he was among the first generation of students taught techniques of drawing and painting from life, a mode of representational realism that was known as modern painting. Nek Dim graduated in 1954 and commenced employment for the United States of America's embassy in Phnom Penh, where 2 years later he was the only one of three artists to receive a pay rise and promotion. In 1957, the US sponsored a six-month trip to the Philippines to study techniques of printing and publishing. And in 1961, 62, and 63, Nek Dim joined US Information Service, or USIS, annual exhibitions in Phnom Penh. Photographs and other records show that these were well attended by Cambodians. The bicycles you can see in the lower picture suggest that the exhibitions were popular among students and not only an urban elite. From 1963 to 67, Nek Dim studied animation in the US studios of the Walt Disney Corporation. Upon his return, he opened a gallery and confirmed his position as Cambodia's most famous artist. His paintings were widely used in advertising, record covers, and diplomatic publications, and the reception of his work was, for most Cambodians, highly mediated. His work adorned the walls of Prince Sihanouk's many residences and appeared in films that the prince and head of state directed. Nek Dim continued painting until the forced evacuation of Phnom Penh in 1975 and died during the Khmer Rouge's reign, reportedly in 1978. The historical moment in question encompasses the years following Cambodian independence in 1953, taking in Prince Sihanouk's Somkhumrech Niyum, or People's Socialist Community Regime, of 1955 to 1970, and the US-backed Khmer Republic military regime of 1970 to 75, headed by General Lon Nol. It ends with the victory of Pol Pot's genocidal Khmer Rouge regime, which reigned from 1975 to 79. Alongside these political shifts, the period also saw significant developments in the arts in Cambodia. Importantly, there was a fruitful cross-pollination between the visual arts, literature, and the various performing arts, including popular music and cinema. The significance of these transmedia intersections has been underexplored. While Nek Dim was the most prominent visual artist of his time, and although substantially more of his paintings survive than of his contemporaries, there remain unavoidable gaps and uncertainties in this history. During Pol Pot's regime, an estimated 80 to 90% of artists and intellectuals were killed as part of a genocide in which around 2 million Cambodians perished, approximating one quarter of the nation's population at the time. Destruction of artworks and archives accompanied the devastation of human life, and sources on the 1960s had also been tightly controlled during Sihanouk's reign. This loss of sources poses an inescapable methodological challenge for research on pre-1975 Cambodian arts and culture, and it is with this in mind that I will consider Nek Dim's paintings in various local contexts, looking also to contemporaneous sources and creations, including songs with which the artist was associated, and mediated environments in which his work was first encountered. Perhaps an attentiveness to intersections across media within a single locality while here born partly of necessity, may also prove enriching elsewhere, as many histories of the Southeast Asian modern privilege intra-regional rather than transmedia intersections, and the sense of regionality that emerges, while productive, is necessarily partial. Let us now turn to look at this painting titled Harvest. The landscape, or in Khmer, the Tukde Khmer, literally Khmer water and soil, is central to modern Khmer constructions of Cambodia. Entrenched and overlapping factors contributing to this include an intensification of long-standing perceptions of threatened borders, the loss of historically Khmer territory to neighbouring nations, a pride in agricultural and riverine fertility and abundance, and spiritual beliefs. The pictorial and discursive image of the landscape is also of defining importance here. And examining shifts in meanings invested in imaged landscapes from the early Sihanouk era in the early 1960s to the years after Lon Nol's 1970 coup enriches our understanding of Nyakdom's repeated painting of remarkably similar landscapes throughout these periods. This painting was painted in 1961 and exhibited as one of five canvases in the second annual USIS exhibition in Phnom Penh. It depicts a group of farmers harvesting rice. Also visible are thatched houses in typical Khmer style and the silhouettes of sugar palms, which were a symbol of Cambodian nationalism. Everything in the painting is imbued with the golden hue of ripe rice, conveying an all-encompassing sense of fertile abundance. A review at the time proposed that, quote, "Harvest depicts strikingly the sunburned face of the man of the soil, diligently doing the work that the nation depends on," end quote. This comment is significant in two ways. Firstly, its naming of the man of the soil is odd, given that five of the eight adults in the foreground are women, including the most prominent figure facing us. Disregarded by the reviewer, these women are not only compositionally central, but also vital to a key ideological message in the image, for it is only the women who wear the checkered scarf, known as a kramar. It is the conspicuous presence of the Khmer scarf on the women that signals to local audiences that these farmers are ethnic Khmer, rather than ethnic Vietnamese. Centuries-old tensions between these neighbours intensified during escalating war at the time, and that it is women chosen as bearers of this nationalist symbol is telling, since in the process of modern nation building, women were called on to play active roles in many fields from which they had previously been marginalised. The review's linking of Nyakdom's painting of the harvest to the diligent work that the nation depends on is also significant for coupling the pictorial image of the landscape to the discursive elevation of agriculture from simply a practical and economic necessity to an ideologically freighted act as part the central foundation of a policy that was termed Khmer Buddhist socialism. Propounded by Sihanouk's regime from the late 1950s, Khmer Buddhist socialism posited that the cooperative communal farming, and especially harvesting, that had been practiced since very long ago, was indeed the source of Khmer socialism and of equality and democracy. Irrigation, hospitals, and various other innovations of the Angkorian era in the 9th to 12th century were seen as being the origins of this cooperative communal farming, which continued to the modern day. In a statement published in 1960, the year before this painting was made, Sihanouk elaborated this theory, announcing that, quote, "Khmer Buddhist socialism bears no relation to the socialism of Marx and Engels because Buddhist theory teaches the led to respect the leaders." Nyakdom's depiction of harvesting in this 1961 painting, seen by audiences familiar with Sihanouk's contemporaneous expounding of Khmer Buddhist socialism, would have been striking for its emphasis on harvest as a communal activity involving both men and women. The harvesters form a human chain, their figures overlapping to visually underscore their interdependence. Just as the presence of the Khmer checkered scarves identify these farmers as specifically Khmer, so too their collectivity further marks them as what was called the source of Khmer socialism. These layered and contextually specific meanings inherent in imaging the landscape have been overlooked by previous commentators. The late Ingrid Muen, a preeminent scholar of modern Cambodian art, regards such paintings as, quote, "nostalgia," since, quote, "they did not portray the new, although they used a new form of representation, And since factories of the Sunkum, the televisions and cars of everyday life, in fact the city as a whole, is missing here. Muin contends that artists, quote, turn to archetypes of the countryside to secure the Cambodian label for their modern paintings, end quote. Muin's comments are insightful. What she does not register, yet thus allows us to see, is the significant notion that the countryside itself took on ideological connotations that were new at the time. Having examined how this 1961 harvest painting ideologically functioned in relation to Sihanouk's policy of Khmer Buddhist socialism, let us turn to another painting, also titled Harvesting, made 11 years later after Sihanouk's fall from power. The visual similarity is striking. Yet upon closer inspection, we'll find several points of contrast making this 1972 painting even more idealizing in its depiction of farmers. In both canvases, one centrally positioned woman looks directly to us. In the earlier painting, the woman is hunched, in loose dark clothing, her face stern and weary, looking away as if pondering her future. By contrast, in the later picture, on the right, the woman stands proud and tall, her slender silhouette revealed by a figure-hugging skirt and blouse. Her face appears youthful and carefree, looking directly and perhaps seductively to us. This woman's fellow villagers in the 1972 painting are engaged in a notably more diverse range of activities than their 1961 counterparts. A man climbs a palm tree, suggesting that it bears ripe fruit. A woman builds a haystack, another tends to chickens. Taken together, these constitute an emphatic display of fecund abundance, demonstrably greater than in the earlier picture. What to make of this idealization of landscape in this 1972 painting? If the earlier picture was made in a moment when cooperative farming was rhetorically linked to Khmer Buddhist socialism, then what contextual and discursive meanings were attached to the imaged landscape by 1972? With civil war raging after 1970, and much of the country subjected to bombing by both Khmer Rouge and American armies, Phnom Penh's population swelled with internal refugees fleeing rural areas, and the city's residents were largely unable to travel through the countryside. Yuk Chang, who was a child at the time, recalls wistfully that, quote, at that time we really missed the countryside. It was really a longing. The image landscape, which in 1961 was a locus of quasi-socialist political fantasy, had by 1972 become a nexus for longing and loss, both physical and emotional, heralded by war. Before we turn to look at Nguyễn Trãm's depiction of women, inextricably linked to the landscape, let us first consider briefly the artist's relationship with the US, and specifically the USIS. After all, in the years between the 1961 painting of The Harvest and this later version, Nguyễn Trãm had spent 4 years studying in California from 1963 to 67. Mapping the timing of Nguyễn Trãm's US study onto the political landscape of Cambodia is revealing. Historian David Chandler describes the years 1963 to 66 as, quote, the first act of the nightmare that terrorized Cambodia after 1970. A period in which the popularity of Sihanouk and his regime began to be seriously challenged. Nguyễn Trãm returned to a culturally and politically quite different Cambodia than the one that he had left. In 1963, anti-US demonstrations began to become increasingly frequent. This woodcut by Nguyễn Trãm's contemporary Sam Yuen captures something of the spirit of the time. Note the US Go Home placard in the top left there. The 1963 USIS exhibition, which Nguyễn Trãm joined and at which he was awarded a prize, would be the final one. In 1964, a riot destroyed the entire USIS library and exhibition space. Unrecorded in previous histories, this was an episode of immense and lasting importance, not least because of the destruction of some 400 paintings by local artists which were stored against the next annual exhibit. This loss of paintings, predating by more than a decade the destruction wrought by the Khmer Rouge, which is most often cited as the reason for the dearth of paintings from the Sihanouk regime, constitutes a catastrophe with clear implications for art historical research. While, as historian David Chandler further notes, few people noticed at the time that a crossroads had been reached, the riots of 1964 were only the beginning of several years of growing disquiet in Cambodian politics. These years of growing turmoil were precisely the years for which Nyak Dim was away studying. That the artist was sent for study in the US was part of a large-scale program. It had been in effect for over a decade, but was significantly expanded around the time of souring diplomatic relations in 1963 and 64. It represents a continuation of the cultural diplomacy exercised in the annual USIS exhibitions as well. By the late 1950s, the US was the single largest source of aid to Cambodia, as the nation took on immense strategic significance due to its proximity to the escalating war in Vietnam and also to Sihanouk's insistence on non-alignment. Cambodia is probably the most critical area in Southeast Asia today, the US ambassador wrote in 1959. Yet he also explained that, quote, in this neutralist and Buddhist country, we find it necessary to use featherbrush techniques. Yet another USIS document rather shockingly announced that the scope of US diplomacy efforts has taken on the form and shape of an atomic cloudburst. Few records survive of Nyak Dim's experience of study in the US, but an impression can be constructed from fragments and from the experiences of his peers. This photograph, circulated online, shows the artist at work with Walt Disney. The US offered Cambodian students and visitors special hospitality. Architect Wee Bun Hap, who was invited to the US several times during the 1960s, recalls visiting Frank Sinatra's house and swimming pool. Internal US documents repeatedly refer to preparing what was called red carpet treatment or full Hollywood treatment for Cambodian guests. That Nyak Dim returned to Cambodia importing the only Ford Mustang in the country at the time is surely suggestive of his experience while abroad. Nyak Dim returned in 1967 to a Cambodia that had no formal relationship with the US, and yet in which a new class of pro-US elites had emerged and been substantially empowered in recent elections. Turning our attention now to Nyak Dim's depiction of women, let us turn to look at this painting, made in 1970 and appearing as the cover of a popular record sung by Sin Sisimut, Cambodia's most beloved singer. In a song titled Net Na Aui Ku, or Who Asked You to Paint, a song for which Nyak Dim himself composed the melody, a female voice interrupts the male singer's description of a picture that he says he has very carefully painted for 3 days without complaint, with the intention to exchange it for love. The song is of the crooning style, and the woman's shrieking interjection starkly contrasts with the lilting verses sung by the man. The woman demands, quote, give it to me, who asked you to paint? And the response offered by the singer slash painter is simply, I paint beautifully, my darling. For him, this is clearly sufficient justification. This painting on the record cover, considered in light of the song and lyrics that would have accompanied the viewing experience for most Cambodians at the time, typifies Nyak Dim's depiction of women. Most striking is the placement of a corner of the woman's sarong in her mouth, compositionally drawing our attention to her open lips. Listening to the song, while looking at this image, we guess that this is the woman whom the singer is addressing, and indeed that this very painting on the record cover is the painting that the singer is describing as being very carefully painted. This woman in the painting is thus surely that woman in the song who we hear interrupting the singer-painter to demand, "Who asked you to paint?" Looking again to the sarong held between her lips, we realise that when this woman opens her mouth to cry out, who asked you to paint, as she will every time the song plays, the sarong will fall from her lips, exposing her breast. Posed like this, the woman cannot verbally defend herself without physically revealing herself. And yet she cannot keep quiet, so indignant is she at being painted by the man in this way. In another painting, also dated 1974, Nyak Dim again depicts an attractive young woman bathing in a flowing stream, again with the corner of her sarong placed between her full and slightly open lips. These women are objectified, yet they are also somehow irrepressible, like the woman who we hear in the song, who refuses to silently assent to being painted by the sleep-deprived man. This apparent tension epitomises the contradiction at the heart of the image of the modern woman in the Cambodian setting. She is called on to participate in the nation-building project, including through her role in the agricultural labour in the landscape, which has been elevated, as we have seen, to the source of what was called Khmer Buddhist socialism, while also to maintain what was called her traditional role. I want to conclude simply by observing that the Cambodian case has hitherto been set aside from most intra-regional accounts of the Southeast Asian modern. This suggests perhaps a certain amnesia, a reluctance to confront exceptional difference. The singularity and devastation of Cambodia's experience of the 1970s, a decade which is taken in recent accounts to be especially pivotal in the art history of this region, constitutes a singular challenge, and one which must be accounted for, not least given the continued exploitation of cultural diplomacy in the region and the unending shadow of war regionally and beyond. Thank you.
Roger, thank you very much. I'd now like to introduce Buiti Thang Mai. Buiti Thang Mai is a lecturer in the Department of Art History, Theory and Criticism at Vietnam University of Fine Arts, Hanoi. And she's also head of the university's Department of Academic Research and International Relations and on the editorial board for the university's journal Art Research. And today she'll be talking to us about research on optimistic characterization, paintings by Chan Van Can, Mai Van Hien, and Nguyen Thu. And answering the mysterious question that if you see the Southeast Asia Gallery upstairs, you may ask, which is, why is Vietnamese wartime art so cheerful? So thank you, Mai.
Good morning. I would like to present my research on optimistic characterization paintings by Chan Van Can, Mai Van Hien, and Nguyen Thu. Vietnamese painters Chan Van Can, Mai Van Hien, and Nguyen Thu witnessed the dark side of the warfare when they joined the army during the First Indochina War in the early 1950s. They also experienced firsthand the hardship of north of Vietnam when the country was recovering economically from its 9 years wars against the French and fighting the Americans for the liberation of the South. In spite of this, their art is by no means pessimistic. Instead of reflecting on losses and suffering caused by the war, as would a number of artists in the world, their artwork describes optimistic moments, such as shoulders happiness when they meet their friends or fellow countrymen. The picturesque scenery of the countryside, the beauty of women wearer, and young volunteers people's excitement at work, and their belief in the victory in the society in the South and the socialist cause in the North. Through art of protest, artists around the world have had to convey messages of peace across national borders. However, art by Chan Van Can, Mai Van Hien, Nguyen Thu shows a different feature, optimism. Prompted by this, the research project aims to answer questions such as, how is optimism expressed as a characteristic in the painting by Chan Van Can, Mai Van Hien, and Nguyen Thu? Why were the artists so optimistic? While the wars were cruel and wartime, life was extremely difficult. What made them see the war from that perspective? And is optimism only found in the paintings by these artists, or is it also seen in works of art by other Vietnamese artists. These three painters, I would like to talk about their artwork. The composition of my research as follows. First, the concept of optimism. Secondly, optimism in Vietnamese modern fine arts. And the finally, expression of optimism in painting by Trần Văn Cần, Mai Văn Hiến, and Nguyễn Thu. First, I would like to clarify the concept of optimism. In Vietnamese, the expression lạc quan is understood as having a perspective or attitude which believes in a good outcome. This is synonymous with the word optimism in English, which is said to have originated from the Latin optimum, meaning the best. Optimism is understood as one's expectation for the best results, no matter the circumstances. In short, optimism is usually understood as belief in a good future, an expectation for the best possible result in whatever circumstances. Realities can be very pessimistic, but because optimism is a mental, emotional state, it can arise even in danger, hardship, or disaster, or suffering. In the 18th century, Voltaire's candidate or optimism satirized Leibniz's optimism. Voltaire's message is that optimism can have a positive effect when it creates a person's or a group's spiritual strength and their belief in good results. On the other hand, Voltaire was savagely satirical in his attack on optimism as disguised or a method of concealing or distorting unpalatable truths. Second, I would like to talk about optimism in Vietnamese modern fine arts. Although Vietnam suffered greatly from three decades of warfare against French and American invaders, tragedy, hatred, or destruction is rarely painted. Most Vietnamese paintings made between 1945 and 1985 depict optimism in terms of the victories made by the National Resistance Movement and the goals of socialist construction. Optimism in Vietnamese fine arts was formed with three main factors as follows. The first factor is Vietnamese mentality during the wars against French and American invaders and during national construction. The artist rightly reflected Vietnamese optimism during this period as well as their own attitude toward the wars. Secondly, during the wars, both artists and audience wished to create and enjoy works which were filled with optimism and which were able to motivate soldiers and ordinary people. Thirdly, the Vietnamese Communist Party and state set for contemporary Vietnamese culture a political task of bringing the revolution of triumph. Therefore, works of art in this period should focus substantially and formally on praising optimism and revolutionary heroism. Art and literary works in this period reflected what artists and authors thought and felt about the world. Like many ordinary Vietnamese people at that time, the artists were optimistic about the future of the country. Many painters and sculptors established their reputation while fighting on the battlefield, visiting air force or navy units or front lines, traveling together with transportation teams along the Cheongseon mountain range, where enemy bombing and shelling was incessant. Most artists who were only teenagers or in their early 20s joined the army to fight foreign invaders and liberate the country. Sometimes they would fight beside soldiers or workers in military campaigns. Other times they would visit squat or mingle with ordinary people in order to paint. Whenever possible, the artist would take notes and paint for soldiers and workers on the spot. A portrait of a soldier or a painting of a match of a daily life in wartime was enormously encouraging, inspiring, giving Vietnamese soldier invisible strength. Another factor of optimism in Vietnamese art was psychology of artists and art lovers during this period. Both artists and art viewers, soldiers and workers, were exposed to bombing and firing on a daily basis. Live on the slim borderline between life and death. I witnessed the cruelty of war and saw their co-fighter sacrifice their life to protect the country. They wanted to watch works of art that describe optimism and would motivate them during their fighting. In 2012, the artist Ding Quile, in his art project Light and Belief, the sketches of life from Vietnamese war, he has interviewed many Vietnamese painters, and all of them expressed that during the wartime, they would like to paint to motivate, to support the war, to against the enemies. As far as artist was concerned, they painted in order to make a contribution to the nation's revolution and serve soldiers and militiamen right on their battlefields. Artists were soldiers on the cultural front. As for art audiences, soldiers and militiamen, they wished to see poster art which would encourage them during their breaks between battles, rather than those which reproduce was disaster they always witnessed every day. Here are some photos, some images. For instance, the exhibition during the wartime in Vietnam. Another important contributing factor to optimism of Vietnamese art in the 1945 to 1985 period was the Communist Party and state policies on culture, literature and art. The Indochina Communist Party's thesis on Vietnamese culture in 1945 identified three principles of the Vietnamese culture revolution. It should be national, popular, and scientific. It was special historical situation and urgent demand of the revolution that gave rise and attention to. First of all, the content of works of literature and art, which should have party and national attributes. Finally, I would like to tell you the expression of optimism in paintings by Trần Văn Cần, Mai Văn Hiến, and Nguyễn Thụ.
Yes, we have it. Here we go.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Okay.
Sorry. Expression of optimism in paintings by Trần Văn Cẩn, Mai Văn Hiến, and Nguyễn Thụ. Mai Văn Hiến's meeting describes a usual meeting in the wartime. The artist does not deal with the large topic of war. Neither does he tell a complicated story or exaggerate the event. Instead, he simply documents wartime life. The color of the painting are bright, creating the impression that the people are going to festivate occasion. This is one of the characteristics of the artist's style. Crowds of people, an excited atmosphere, happy facial expressions. The bright red of the blouse of the girl is wearing draws viewers' attention to what the artist wants to tell. The meeting between a soldier and a female volunteer carrier on their way to the battlefield. Perhaps they are from the same village and come across each other. While they are busy moving to the front, they recognize each other. At the time when a soldier met other soldiers or volunteer workers while matching, he would often look for fellow villagers to inquire about his native place. This always happened during the wartime in Vietnam. French line volunteers, workers, would also wish to meet friends or people from their village or town in order to exchange information. They would be extremely happy hearing people speak with the same accents as there. In addition to recording the encounter between the young man and the girl, the meeting manages to describe the busy atmosphere of soldiers and volunteer workers going to the battlefield. People are so excited because they are going to make a contribution to the war. Records from that time show that when there were no vehicles or horses, the young people would go barefooted. They carry goods on their shoulders or their backs. Many of them injured their feet, yet regrouping places would ebullient every night as if there was a festival going on there. Their optimism and belief in victory explains why hardship could not prevent the youth from joining the army to defeat the enemy and protect the country, and why Vietnamese volunteer workers with only basic tools could fulfill their logistic tasks under extremely difficult circumstances. The painting successfully reflects the high moral of soldiers and people during the war. Therefore, it became famous as soon as the painting was displayed. It served as an invaluable source of information on a heroic period in the history of the Vietnamese people. The second painting, I would like to talk about Nguyễn Thụ, a mountain village, a mountainside village. This painting is more a landscape than a painting of people's lives. The background is the springtime in a mountainous village in the north. Villagers are welcoming soldiers arriving at the village on horses. Without a careful look, the audience can hardly recognize the soldier. There is no smoke or fire typical of a war. There is no description of hardship, of mountain climbing or river crossing either. The artist simply presents a poetic, romantic landscape. He focuses on the majestic mountains, fresh white flowers, spring weather and landscape. Nguyễn Thụ silk paintings are characterized by such elements as weather, scenery, and the beauty of subject, rather than examining the character's psychology or dealing with complicated or profound themes. Unlike many silk painters in Vietnam who would paint and then wash the silk many times as the color became deeper and richer, Nguyễn Thụ chose to paint directly onto the silk in the style of water ink. In this painting, the shoulder strip in the spring is relaxing rather than hurried. Thus, suggestive of optimism. The scenery is realistic yet romantic. Viewers only see in the trip peace and beautiful instead of hardship or the difficulty. This is a common characteristic of Vietnamese artists' work on the theme military matches, making use of the beauty of nature and landscapes. However, Nguyễn Thụ managed to elevate this theme to a kind of poetry through the language of painting silk. Finally, I would like to speak about Trần Văn Cẩn's painting. Trần Văn Cẩn's Tát Nước Đồng Chiêm, Watering the Rice, Paddies. The painting depicts peasants' happiness when they join cooperatives and reflects the movement of rural and agriculture collectivization in the north in the early years of liberation from the French occupation. Combining Western perspective with Oriental decoration, the painting contains special depth while showcasing the beauty of the characters and scenery. The characters in the painting have different postures and moves. They are depicted working hard yet happily and excitedly. All details support the author's visual concept and the theme of the painting. The artist has masterly skills of lacquer painting. Thus, he has produced a unique painting on agriculture work. The painting brightens because of the wisely chosen colors for the vegetables, plants, earthen banks and clothes. Soft touches help to shape the characters and decorate the entire painting. In particular, the farmer's action of watering are depicted with the rhythms like a dance, creating the impression that they are at a festival. The painting reminds of the Zen policy of pricing collective labor. Although the country was still poor, prosperity was promising, and despite hardship, people were happy, optimistic, and believed in the socialist cause. I would like to conclude my research. During the war, literature and art in Vietnam was subject to the party's leadership with a focus on fulfillment of the immediate political task, such as communication, promotion of the fighting spirit and diligence, and encouragement of the people, first and foremost workers, farmers, and soldiers. The party's objective coincided with that the majority of Vietnamese in general and the literary and arts circles in particular. That's why optimism was clearly not a quality of individual artists, but came alive as the general ideological thread running through Vietnamese art. Above all, it helped the Vietnamese revolutionary government call on people to unite together and fight for independence, freedom, and national unification. Art, therefore, has become part of the nation's strength. This article, which is on the optimism in paintings by Trần Văn Cẩn, Mai Văn Hiến, and Nguyễn Thụ, shows the optimism and revolutionary heroism the Vietnamese have upheld during the war and socialist construction. Thank you.
Thank you so much to all three speakers. And even with technical difficulties, our speakers have been admirably on time. So we have a reasonably generous period for questions. While you gather your thoughts in the audience, I'd like to offer a small reflection on the papers that we've heard, and also to ask some of the speakers to expand slightly more on certain points. It's really striking to me that across these three papers and in the different contexts that they reflect, what we can notice is a remarkable privileging of the figurative. And it's remarkable because I suppose if we were trying to locate the modern from a Euro-American perspective, we would search for something quite different. And yet in all three of these contexts, it's the realistic and the figurative that prevails. And the other thing that seems particularly interesting is that this has happened in these three contexts despite the ideological environment which they were in. So I was quite amazed to see in Tanavi's presentation that the anti-communist memorials bear a very striking stylistic resemblance to socialist realism. So while we might not be surprised to hear that the figurative is privileged in Vietnam where socialist realism is the prevailing style, it seems quite striking that it has persistence and privileging in the Cambodian and the Northern Thai context that we heard about. So perhaps to begin, I could ask Roger and Tanavi perhaps to expand further on why you think that might have come about. And also, given the regional frame of the Ambitious Alignments project, is this something that you observed in other Southeast Asian contexts?
Thank you, that's a great question. The conventional wisdom, such as it is, the prior scholarship on the Cambodian modern, has emphasized the ways in which the French colonial authorities forbade representational drawing and painting, and that such figuration emerged suddenly around the time of 1945, and that thereafter was embraced because of its newness and because of its newness in its local context and its connection to various other innovations in education and so on. And that account, I think, is useful and interesting for thinking through that question, but there is another side to it, which various painters who were amongst that first generation, along with Nhạc Đệm, to be taught representational painting, recall saying, it wasn't new. We've always drawn what we saw. If you look at the ways in which the bas-reliefs in the temples of Angkor, the ways in which temple paintings have been made, even the ways in which our abstracted ornamental designs in temples are derived from natural forms, Khmer art, visual art, has always been representational in a certain way. This is the other narrative that emerges from oral accounts from artists at the time. So I given the loss of sources, given the fact that that first generation of artists has now all, nearly all passed away, I don't think that we can answer with confidence why the representational was privileged above any other forms. But I think that in terms of its relationship to kind of parallel kinds of modernisms that you find in the West, I think that there's what I would instead emphasize is that kind of transmedia intersection that you see between the various visual and other arts, and the fact that painters of easel paintings also painted record covers, film posters, and so on. I think those kind of transmedia intersections are much more important than the kind of medium specificity that you see being privileged in various forms of your American modernism. So that's me. What do you think, Tanabe?
In response to your remarks about the socialist realism, I would say that realism in Thailand is not limited to this particular period or the Cold War period. It has been like that since the very beginning of the Thai modern art, because considering the Thai traditional art, they are two-dimensional, basically. So they are not quite realistic or naturalistic. But with the encounter with Western culture, realism became modernist. Not modernist, like a modern form of Thai art. And that can be found in painting, sculptures, and monuments, and all kind of art forms. But it seems that in the monuments practice, well, while in other kind of fine art practice structures and all those things, they change quite a lot through times. But for monument practice, figurative remain major character. And I think that has very much to do with the army's attitude about how to represent themselves to the people. While the fine art artists might change the style and medium to many other things since the beginning of modern Thai art, to now, the monument remain the same. So even after the Cold War period, the most recent monument in Thailand, the Monument Park in Hua Hin, that depicts the Seven Kings in the past, also very figurative, very huge, like, huge sculpture of the king. So I think figuration has very much to do with the depiction of power, of the state power. It's the most comprehensible form, and it's very easy for the people to understand, unlike abstract or any other things that people, non-art people, might find it difficult. So, and I think that is the reason why figurative has always been popular among Thai art and monument practice.
Thank you. And I also have a follow-up question for Mai. So Mai, you took us through the different factors that led to optimism in Vietnamese painting in this period. And partly this was to do with the psychology of individuals and partly to do with a desire to build morale in general in the difficult wartime environment. But of course also you mentioned the ideological environment and the ideological policies and structures which supported this kind of art. I'd really like you to expand further on this, because particularly when we talk about paintings from the late 1950s, these are paintings that emerge from a context of quite intense and bitter ideological struggle over the direction of culture. The late 1950s saw, you know, Vietnam's answer, I guess, to the 100 Flowers movement in the Nguyen Van Dai Pham affair, and there was quite heated debate about what sort of cultural expression should be promoted. And in fact, I guess optimism is the winning strand of that debate, but other options were being put forward at that time. So could you tell us a bit more about that 1950s context and the ideological context for optimism?
Thank you for your question. Doing this research, I'm not against the artists who depict the pessimism in their art, paintings or sculpture, etc. I think there are many ways the artist could express their thoughts, their idea, their art. The importance is about how they express in how they create, how they express, how they depict this in by their art. In 1950s, in Vietnam, there was a group of artists, writers, musicians, painters, who belonged to a group named Nhân Văn Giai Phẩm. They have another perspective about the society, about the ideology. And at that time, some of them were not supported by the Communist Party and the artists who follow the Communist Party. However, nowadays, many of them have received the award, like a Ho Chi Minh Award, a very honorable award in Vietnam of art and culture. It means today we understand their art, their talent, and their perspective is not wrong. So your question about what do I think about the ideology at that time? Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that. I think it's helpful to have more background on the ideological context. So perhaps with that, could I open to the floor for questions? I believe we have a roving microphone, so if anyone would like to raise their hand.
My question is for Roger. Thank you so much, Roger, for a really interesting paper. You may not be able to answer this. I actually have two questions that are related. You may not be able to answer because of the scarcity of archival resources, but I was wondering more about the influence of the USIS in the artistic scene in Phnom Penh in Cambodia during the 50s and early 60s. And, you know, if they're putting on these large exhibitions, presumably there would be some kind of prize awarded. I don't know. Would they be also helping to set the standards for painting and for artistic production? And so I'm thinking about the 1961 Harvest painting and if that wholly reflected a kind of Khmer Buddhist socialism, or what kind of, you know, power or influence did the USIS have in the scene at the time? And then in a related vein, this may be a totally unfair question, but, you know, coming from a photography background myself, I'm curious to know if there was a Family of Man show exhibited by the USIS in Phnom Penh or in Cambodia and in other areas, and if so, how that was received.
Thanks, they're really interesting questions. On the second, there was no Family of Man exhibition. There were lots of exhibitions of photographs which were displayed and presented and contextualized in a way that very much set them apart from art. So there was no tradition of photography as art that I'm aware of until much later. On your first question, the USIS exhibitions were competitions, and they did prescribe a theme that all artists must adhere to. And so there have been some who have said that therefore they helped to shape the kind of art that was being made. But the theme was in fact very broad. It was simply that entries must depict some aspect of Cambodian life or people. And all surviving evidence suggests that in fact Cambodian artists were already doing so. Before the USIX exhibition, several years before, there was an artist-initiated group called the Association of Modern Khmer Painters, who also organised annual group exhibitions, which, from what we can tell, not having surviving works, but having lists of titles and having the oral testimony of those involved, from what we can tell, those exhibitions, organised solely by Cambodian artists, also had paintings of very similar aesthetics and themes. On the other hand, the USIS also organised other exhibitions that seemed to have very little impact for Cambodians. They presented a show by a female artist who was also the wife of a US diplomat, whose paintings essentially resembled the works of Cambodian artists. The show was called something like Cambodian Scenes and Faces, So it was very much landscapes and portraits as well. She, in the exhibition pamphlet and apparently in talks that she gave, talked about the importance of women exhibiting, and that doesn't seem to have been something that was taken up by Cambodian artists or organisers at all at the time. So, in short, I would say the influence of the US in terms of shaping the kind of art that was being made from the limited evidence that we had was fairly limited, but in terms of creating a context where exhibitions solely and exclusively of art were prominent in the Cambodian cultural landscape, they were very important because there were none others at the time. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I have a question for Tanavin. I'm wondering if you would agree that in your discussion about monuments and the kingdom, and you put the king in quotes, that you would look back even further to the 1920s and the 30s in Thailand, where I think the king invited, his name escapes me, an Italian sculptor who then started the school of art in Thailand. I mean, we've always known that Thailand, as an Asian country, was never colonized, but there's another school of thought that said that rolling back into the 19th century, many of the notions of royalty and elite was actually borrowed from Europe. And so you've got that establishment of the royal family looking like a European royal family, and then you've got the art schools being started by an Italian sculptor who actually came. So I'm just wondering, you know, it's important to look back to the religion and the temple reliefs and all that. But clearly the influence of what you had discussed, you know, the monuments and the gardens and the, you know, the inscriptions and all that, that has got to have some influence from what actually happened in the previous sort of 50 to 100 years coming from Europe. Would you agree with that?
Thank you for your question. And yes, I do agree with that. I actually did another research. Actually, my PhD thesis on that period, the 30s and 50s. And well, that's Italian sculpture, what's in Piracy, Corrado Ferraci. He came to Thailand actually before the 1932 revolution. So that means that at the beginning, he served the king, King Rama VI. And it's what him, but well, also some former Italian artists, sculptors, and painters before him introduced realism into Thai court. But yes, he was the first one to establish the art school, but the establishment of the art school, which is now Silapakorn University, took place during the revolutionary period. That means the king was not the sovereignty, not the supreme power of that period as well. So there is a, what should I say, an interruption or the disruption in this long time of artistic and monumental practice in Thailand, even though figuration has always been there. But the person, the sovereign power was not the same. Yeah, and I agree that realism in Thai art came from, derived from Europe, but I think it is necessary to relate it to a local context, a local circumstances of the time as well. Otherwise, it would be like, because these are state arts, and when the state power change, the patron of art changed from the king, from the royal family to the commoner government, and then it came back to be the royal family again after the coup in 1947. It is necessary, I think, to discuss it in this kind of context and this thing, which each period that look very similar in appearance, but they are quite different.
Thank you for all the presentations. They were all very good. I have a question for Mai concerning ideology again, a little bit following up from what Phoebe asked, concerning the ideological prescription of the regime for optimistic painting in the period that you discussed in your paper, which is 40s, 50s, the First and Second Indochina Wars. My question is that, and you did mention that the regime has now rehabilitated some of the artists who were not as optimistic as they were required to be during those periods. So I'm interested to know whether there's actually anything definite that changed the regime, the current regime, and that sort of from the 90s onwards changed official prescriptions regarding the content of paintings and optimism, or whether that, because in the 90s we see art that doesn't look optimistic at all in certain quarters. So I'm wondering whether there was anything, there's an edict or any sort of actual change, official change within official paperwork, etc., that says that artists are now free to not be so optimistic, excuse me, or not, or whether this is just something that happens more organically.
Thank you, Iola Lenzi, for your question. It's very interesting, and it gives me an opportunity to talk more about Vietnamese art and culture. In fact, the period of time from 1945 to 1975, it was the time Vietnamese art follow the socialist reason. At that time, most Vietnamese artists, they only paint about the optimism. Of course, some of them not want to paint about optimism. For example, in literature, there was a writer who has written a poetic, and in his painting, writing, he has written some sentences like this, and it was against it at that time by the government and the people who from the Communist Party. His poetic like this: I walk in the street. I see no houses, nothing. I just see the raining on the color of the red flag. And at that time, it was terrible to him because some people thought that his poetic like against the Communist Party and expressed the pessimism. Maybe that's not properly to express at that time. However, after đổi mới policy since 1986, Vietnam opened the door to the world, and we have changed in many fields, not only in art. And many people now today, they have open eye, not like before. Many artists, writers, musicians, they want to make art, to write, not like the art before. They look for something new, and they want to, maybe they also want to paint about the world, but in different perspectives. And many writers, many critics, they have written, and some even want to examine the art and the papers has written about art before, and many people they want to change and they look forward to the new things, and there are some conferences have talked and have discussed about the artist, the writer in the period 1950s, and I would like to say that by many work, many conferences and papers from some artist writer who have written about nhân văn giai phẩm group, and that made people change their perspective, their viewing about the artists during the 1950s who have written and paint about pessimism.
Thank you so much for that very comprehensive answer. Okay, we're about to go to lunch, so maybe if we just have one last burning question from up the back. Thank you very much.
Hello, this question is for Kun Tanavi. Could you just share with us, in your field research, how you went about accessing these monuments, and also did you come in touch with the Department of Fine Arts? Who were the commissioners? Who were the architects? Who were the, you know, the people who engineered this, all these programs?
Okay, thank you. I started with archival research at the National Archives, and I look at files from the Fine Art Department, but I did not find much information on these monuments other than general information like years, names of designers and the location and all that. And then I had a field trip to the north. Some of the monuments were in the military camps, but they're also open for public, so I just got there. Some of them are totally in public place, like beside the road or in the mountain, in the valley, so I could access to all these places quite easily. But in terms of historical record of these monuments, as I said, in the National Archive, they didn't have much. So I kind of struggled to get historical information.
Okay, I think with that we'd better conclude so that you have time to eat, but please join me in thanking our wonderful three presenters for creating such a great start to the workshop.